Rivalries are the lifeblood of hockey.
Puck drops, fans are gonna be screaming at you.
It's so intense, so passionate, and it borders on hatred.
When Chicago plays St. Louis, players care. Do they ever care?
Davis, Naaman covered up, and now he comes up swinging.
First word that comes to my mind is pain and rivalries.
Roenick seems to be the target. Featherstone first wanted him. Now Kelly Chase tries to rough him up.
Rivalries do not merely explain hockey. They define hockey.
And it'll be a little extra coming from there.
The build-up where it gets personal.
They're the team to beat in our division this year. Their motivation is to be the best. The
team that wins the cup has that target.
There's some real hatred there.
With iconic stars like Bobby Hull and Stan Mikita, the Chicago Blackhawks were a proud Original Six franchise.
The Blackhawks are the world champions.
They won their third Stanley Cup, their only championship of the Original Six era, in 1961. And when the NHL decided to add six teams for the 1967 season, Chicago played a pivotal role in the awarding of a franchise to St. Louis, creating the team that would become a principal rival through parts of six decades.
The St. Louis Blues are basically a real estate deal. If you go back to the first expansion in 1967, the Blues were a conditional franchise. Either St. Louis or Baltimore was going to get the franchise, but Arthur Wirtz, who owned the Blackhawks, and James Norris, who owned the Red Wings, they had this old arena in St. Louis that had been built in the late 20s. They wanted to get rid of this white elephant. So for $4 million to take the building off their hands, St. Louis and the Solomons could have a team. The Blues got a team and Baltimore didn't.
Hello, I'm Jay Randolph. Behind me you see the newly refurbished arena, the home of the Blues.
The old arena, Checker Dome, people on Saturday nights in particular would dress up to the nines to go to see the Blues play.
He scored!
The place just rocked. People there loved their Blues, and especially on Saturday night.
The expansion teams were lumped in the same division, guaranteeing that one of the newcomers would have a berth in the Stanley Cup final. For the first three seasons of the original 12, the Blues emerged to play for the Cup, led by their young coach, Scotty Bowman.
Express your feelings, Les, because it was a great series. I think both teams played the best they could.
Well, those fans were really excited out there tonight, weren't they?
I don't think they were any more excited than we were, but we were all excited together.
Despite its relative success, the Blues were swept in all three finals, underscoring the disparity between the NHL's old and new. St. Louis could not shake the perception that it was little more than Chicago's country cousin, 300 miles southwest down I-55.
They were a good team, but they never had the game breaker. Never had the Bobby Hull or the Stan Mikita, you know, those are the game breakers.
In 1970, the Baby Blues were placed in the same division as the tradition-rich Blackhawks. The rivalry developed, but the feeling of parity with many of the Blues players did not.
It's supposed to be the best league in the world, and I'm on one of those teams, and I'm damn proud of it.
I can tell you volumes about how St. Louis had to crawl on their knees all the years I was there to kiss Chicago's rear end. 97% of the concessions went to the Chicago Blackhawks, and that was part of the deal when St. Louis came in the league. We just didn't have the financial resources 99% of the time to compete with what
Chicago did.
For those invested, the challenge was personal, and the combination of familiarity and proximity turned a slow, simmering rivalry into one that would soon boil over.
Chicago, you're in for a few surprises, because the new St. Louis Blues have put the check back in the Checkerdome.
Oh, the old Norris days were pretty brutal.
Jeremy Roenick took a stick right across the chops.
That was our rivalry. They were there to stop us, and we were there to score on them.
A long shot redirected.
Our division was known as the toughest. Black and blue bruises. Playing against the Blues were battles.
An electrifying rush up the ice by Roenick.
The electricity that would go through the arena, it was scary.
The puck is loose, but the whistle has sounded.
It was person to person and situation to situation. But then when you put it all together, it's the Blues against the Blackhawks. And every shift, there was excitement.
So much goes into a great sports rivalry. And for Blackhawks Blues, the Old Barns created the perfect ambience.
You got it in the old St. Louis Arena with that atmosphere and the seats that went straight up and it felt like they were all over you. And then you go to Chicago Stadium, the loudest place, 22,000 people, and it's just, you can barely hear yourself think, it's so loud. It was exciting.
We're on the blue line for the anthem, and I looked up and I saw in the upper balcony two dolls hanging, and it was mine and Holly's numbers on them. And I looked at Holly, go, hey, I go, look up there. And he looks up and he goes, how cool is that? You know, like the ultimate honor that they want to kill you today.
If you were ever there, you understand how loud the organ was playing and the singer was singing and the crowd was cheering at the top of its lungs. And I would just look around and just relish it and just absorb that energy. And other guys were shaking in their boots.
Other players feared walking out into the ice because those Chicago fans in such a tight-knit area, everything was right on top of you. There was not a barn that was louder, that was more passionate, and more excitement and energy than Chicago Stadium. None, ever.
The rivalry already had atmosphere. Now playoff games amped up the intensity and the decibels. 1988 marked the start of a string of playoff confrontations.
Centered at Hall, tying rebound, they score! Brad Hall all alone on the doorstep.
The Blues prevailed, but they would meet again the following spring when a new character would become the face of this rivalry.
My first playoff game, I took a skate to my nose and got about 15 or 18 stitches right up the side of my nose. And then the third period got tangled up with Glenn Featherstone behind the net, started jawing with him, and he cross-checked me right in the mouth, knocked all my teeth out in the front, and scored the game-winning goal in the third. It was pretty cool. It doesn't sound like it was cool, but, you know, in your first playoff game, you get your teeth knocked out. That's a good welcoming into not only the NHL, but into a pretty intense rivalry.
That's the nature of the beast. When you're the guy scoring goals, there's going to be someone there playing hard against you.
There were some marquee players in those games. There were some Hall of Famers in those games. So in addition to the intensity and the toughness, there was great skill.
Along with hate and rivalry, respect and rivalry also is right there.
Led by their engaging stars, the franchises met again the next year.
People get amped up for it. You better be ready. And if you're not on your game, you're gonna be embarrassed or you're gonna get hurt. You have to still play your game, but you better play it at a higher tempo and a higher emotion. And so those playoff games were a lot of fun to play in.
I think it meant more back then in terms of the teams that you hated than it might be in today's modern game. We always felt like we were the better team.
They were barely edging their closest rivals in seven games.
When you play a team 5 out of 6 years in the playoffs, oh, good heavens. You want to talk about a rivalry? That was about as good as it got in the NHL in those days.
But the temperature of this heated rivalry was about to soar on the ice and behind the benches.
And we got a problem in front of the Hawk bench.
Every game kind of a war, and then you play him in the playoffs, and that's what rivalry is all about.
This is an intense individual when he played. He's probably more intense as a coach.
They say they bring out the best in people, but they also bring out the worst in people. I wanted to go to war every night, and anything that was in my way was in my team's way.
We carried that competitive edge right to the line, and maybe went over the line and carried it to the limit, but there are some great things about having rivalries of that nature with that much intensity.
Three straight playoff series beginning in 1988 raised the heat. Although the Blues and Hawks would not meet in the spring of 91, a late season game in Chicago, St. Patrick's Day, would become the ill-tempered hallmark of this Midwest rivalry.
That was a wild game.
Roenick seems to be the target. Featherstone first wanted him. Now Kelly Chase tries to rough him up. Here comes Goulet in there. And we got a problem in front of the Hawk bench. It's a two-on-one against Roenick.
Chaser and Kimmel both came at me and beat the tar out of me at the same time.
The Hawk bench is furious. Players almost coming over.
It was very intense. There were a couple dirty things that had happened each way.
Kelly Chase had had enough of Jeremy Roenick, and he decided he was going to go and take care of business.
They had all of their supposed big tough guys on the ice.
Once that fracas got taken care of, Brian Sutter put Adam Oates and I on the ice, and out came a plethora of very tough gentlemen from the Blackhawks.
We have the potential for trouble here.
We carried that competitive edge right to the line, and it maybe went over the line.
Now Stephen just cross-checked Presley.
That's what rivalries bring out. They say they bring out the best in people, but they also bring out the worst in people.
I still remember the crowd of the stadium is going crazy. And then Dave Manson goes to Scott Stevens and motions to come out to center ice.
They're gonna be one-on-one here.
All of a sudden, the other four guys on each team are fighting. They sort of stop to see, wow, because those were two of the toughest customers in the entire NHL.
Now they come together.
They stood out at center ice and started chucking.
And two of the toughest defensemen in the league are slugging it out. And now Manson gets a ball. A big right hand by Manson. Stevens trying to hang in there with him.
That was definitely a heavyweight bout.
Now Stevens has been cut badly, it appears, around the eye. And Dave Manson really handed it to him in that altercation.
It was bedlam out there for about a half hour. There was gloves and sticks and elbow pads everywhere.
Brian Sutter and Mike Keenan are talking about the intents and strategies in this game.
Two coaches, Mike Keenan and Brian Sutter, were nose to nose at the glass. We thought they were going to fight.
It was quite ironical because beside me was Darryl Sutter. And the other side was Brian Sutter, Rich Sutter. It was a competitive moment. We had a great deal of respect for each other, but the teams were very intense, and the brothers were very intense at that moment.
It wasn't just a game, it was a war, and you did not want to lose to one of your brother's teams. And so rivalries, again, between the Blackhawks and the Blues were intensified because of that.
It just kept going on and on, and a fight would break out behind the net, and then there'd be one at center ice. This was one of the more vicious brawls in modern NHL history.
1 year after the massacre, heavily favored Chicago had Stanley Cup aspirations and met the Blues in another pressure-packed playoff series.
I love the pressure situations. I love being the guy that elated one city and deflated the other one. I did that to St. Louis a couple times.
The series was dominated by a budding superstar who would blossom as the face of the Blackhawks.
Pass taken by Roenick, around to check, fires, he scores!
That was the year that Jeremy Roenick really, I think, came into his own to a certain extent. We had some excellent players, and we had a nasty edge to our game.
The Blackhawks have beaten the St. Louis Blues 4-2 in the series.
It was a difficult series to win because of the rival and the competition, but we were able to win that series and then move on to the Stanley Cup Finals.
The Blackhawks had won three straight series against their Midwest neighbors and were coming off a regular season in which they had posted the best record in the conference. But none of that mattered in a memorable Norris Division semifinal.
Here's Emerson over the line. Fires! Belfour out of the net to challenge him. Made the save and covered up, and now he comes up swinging.
The Blues took a shocking 3-0 series lead. And in the desperation of Game 4 overtime, Blackhawks goalie Ed Belfour morphed into Crazy Eddie.
Shoots it in. Chelios got a rough ride from Lowry. Good clean hit. Here's Janney trying to set her shot. They score! Blues win!
Eddie was one of those guys that when he didn't like something, he was going to let you know it. He chased the referees around, got in their face.
Ed Belfour got caught behind the net, and a shot from the near board went into the vacated goal.
Not only did he flip out on the ice, but he flipped out in the locker room. He broke pretty much everything that St. Louis had. You know, when it ends the season, there's a lot of emotions. And when Eddie got the anger, he just, don't even go near him. Don't go in the locker room. Just let him vent for 25, 30 minutes, and then enter. Eddie lost his mind.
The St. Louis Blues have swept the Blackhawks in stunning fashion. The St. Louis crowd alive. The Blackhawks season, amazingly, is over.
Eddie was a different guy. And I'm sure his teammates thought that, every trainer thought that, and a lot of coaches thought that. But you know what? Eddie Belfour is a winner. You expect that out of winners. Everybody reacts to those things differently when you want to win and you want to be successful. I don't blame him. Don't blame him one bit.
Belfour tried to get back and hit him and deflected in. He was trying to get a call for interference, but that wasn't the case. Sudden death for the Blackhawks. A disappointing finish to an otherwise solid season.
Losing to a rival in the late 80s, early 90s, you didn't get over that for a long time until you met them again the next year. It would sink into your stomach and you would remember it and you'd be so mad. To lose back then to a rival was gut-wrenching. Gut-wrenching.
After 93, the teams met in the playoffs only one more time. St. Louis, led by current Hawks coach Joel Quenneville, won in five games. But the rebirth of the Blues and the resurgence of the Hawks have the rivalry on the brink of new and perhaps dizzying heights.
I think they're definitely our main threat in our division and as good as any team in the league.
WGN Chicago, we're talking NHL hockey rivalries. Your thoughts, Blues, Hawks?
I think St. Louis is going to pick up that rivalry with the Hawks. As close as they are, it looks like a natural rivalry.
They play hard. They make you pay a price when you play against the St. Louis Blues.
They're running this ridiculous Keep the Red Out campaign in St. Louis. They don't want Hawk fans to be able to come down there and invade their building.
At some point, you're going to have to play the St. Louis Blues to get out of your division, to get to the conference final. And when you play a team like St. Louis, you're going to feel like a nine-game series. It's going to take its physical toll.
The Blackhawks are Stanley Cup champions!
The Blackhawks have won two of the past four Stanley Cups. The Blues have not reached the final since 1970, still trying to escape the shadow of its big-shouldered cousin.
Way to step up, big!
For us recently, Chicago's been successful. We're a young team that ultimately wants to aspire to be in their position. We feel that we can get there, and they're a team that's always standing in our way.
With Chicago's success that they've had, it's a good thing because what it does is it drives you as a franchise to become better than them. In St. Louis, we were going through a real serious rebuild. And so we'd play Chicago at home, and damn, half the building were Chicago fans. And we'd be the home team, and there was too many people there in red, to be honest with you.
When we play at home, a lot of Chicago transplants that come to the game, and we're not too happy when we hear them cheering in our stands, and it's something that just keeps building every year.
Every game we play against St. Louis, especially in their building, is... It's a playoff game.
It seems like every whistle, you get that Andrew Shaw now that seems to be gasoline on the fire.
Sounds about right. It's something I've always done.
I think I feed off it. More than a league, I strive for it. I love it.
You know, guys like that, you like to laugh at times, but other times they're under your skin. And, you know, we've got a few guys like that too. And it's just seems to be building and building and building a better rivalry.
Propelled by their record start last season, the Hawks long had clinched a playoff spot when they visited St. Louis April 14th. The Blues, however, were still battling for a spot in the top eight in the Western Conference, and tensions flared.
I mean, I remember that first period. It was extremely intense. I remember a little flurry there where I had a hit on Andrew Shaw and just seemed to escalate from there.
I've always pushed myself to try to get under people's skin, you know, whatever it takes, and it seems to be working for me.
What happened the last game isn't quite forgotten, so it definitely gets personal after a while.
Throughout the decades, clashing personalities have fueled the bad blood. Now, the current team leaders personify the rivalry.
Captains of these teams, David Backes and Jonathan Toews, you see so many similarities. Toews is a more skilled player and a more decorated player, but Backes is the same kind of determined player that Toews is.
Backes has them back in front.
Jonathan Toews and I tend to be on the ice together a lot, and a guy that's had tons of success I respect as a hockey player, but a guy that hopefully get the better of.
In 2010, prior to the Vancouver Olympics, David Backes, who would represent the United States, went on a Fists Across Canada tour, picking on Canadian Olympians. Might have been circumstance, might have been something else, but he and Captain Serious, John Toews, got into a scrap. It's a pretty good one.
Look at Backes and Toews.
I'm not the first guy who's going to drop his gloves, but there are some moments where I feel like it's the right thing to do.
Some lefts and some rights, and now an uppercut by Backes.
Play against each other, and there's some real hatred there.
That one moment there, I feel like I had something to prove against him.
And they're butting heads, going head to head. And boy, is Backes ever given it to him, and he stops there.
I'd say it's like a trip to the dentist, and then they realize that they made a mistake, so you got to come back the day after.
And the future holds many painful days after. The Blues-Hawks rivalry has ripened since the 1967 expansion. Now with realignment and Detroit moving to the east, St. Louis is likely to supplant the Red Wings as Chicago's biggest foe.
Covered up, and now he comes up swinging.
A rivalry that began six decades ago.
And we got a problem in front of the Hawks bench. It's a two-on-one against Roenick.
One that deepened when some of the leading stars figured in its most compelling moments.
And there'll be a little entry coming from there.
And seems poised to become among the NHL's best.